In this example, we're going to look at how to calculate the effectiveness factor when we have a catalytic reaction and one catalyst pore. And so we've represented this pore as being very long compared to its diameter. So this is not the scale representation, and the break here in the diagram is meant to indicate that the length is much larger than the diameter. To make this calculation easier, the catalyst, the green, is on the wall of this pore, but it's not on the end. So what we want to do is determine how effectively we're using the catalyst, namely, what is the rate of reaction in this pore divided by the rate if diffusion was sufficiently fast that the reactant concentration is the same everywhere inside the pore. And to do this, we have to calculate what is the concentration as a function of distance down this pore. And we're going to do this for a first order reaction. We're going to do a material balance. So what I'm going to look at is a small volume, a differential volume. This will be x equals 0. This will be x. This is x plus dx, and then this is x equal L, the length of the pore. And I want to do a mass balance for just an A goes to B reaction. I'll do a balance on A at steady state. So there's no accumulation, but I have diffusion of the reactant into this volume that we're looking at here. I have diffusion out. They are not the same because I have what I'll call a rate of generation, a rate of reaction, where if I have A being made in there, it'd be positive. A is being used up, it's negative. So let's look at the first term, diffusion in. Well, the area for diffusion and then the flux is diffusivity of A and the concentration gradient. The negative sign is present because the diffusion goes from high concentration to low concentration. This is the area, and this is the flux, and this is evaluated at x. And then I have the same type term evaluated at x plus dx. And then the last term is the generation term. I have A reacting, so it's a negative. It's a rate constant times the concentration of A because it's first order. And this rate constant is defined per area of catalyst, so then I need to multiply by the area of the catalyst in this differential volume. So that's pi times the diameter times the length of that differential volume. These are all the terms in the mass balance. Have to have consistent units for K since I'm talking about the surface available for reaction. And then I need boundary conditions. And the two boundary conditions are first that at x equals L, we'll call this concentration CAS. And at x equals 0, there's no flux through the wall. In other words, it's a solid wall, so A does not diffuse through the wall, which means the concentration gradient at that point must be 0. I can now simplify the material balance. First thing I'll do is cancel the pi terms, and I'll cancel one of the diameter terms. And then I'll combine the first two terms. So I factored out common terms for the first two terms and reordered this negative times this negative means this term is positive. So I can divide both terms by dx. And we recognize that this term here then is a derivative. And so this means we end up with a second derivative. So I wrote the derivative, then I rearranged so the second derivative is on one side. And then what I've done on the right here is just to define a new variable to make it easier to manipulate. And I define this as lambda squared because I already know the answer and know that's a more convenient way to define it. So now I can solve this differential equation. And the solution I'm looking for is when I differentiate the concentration of A twice, I get back the concentration of A multiplied by a constant. The solution of this would be an exponential. So e to the lambda x or e to the minus lambda x, either one is going to be a solution. So what we're going to use then is hyperbolic cosine of lambda x as our solution, because this is equal to the sum of e to the lambda x, e to the minus lambda x over 2, and both of those, as we said, were solution. So what we're going to say then is the concentration of A is some constant times the hyperbolic cosine of lambda times x. And this has to satisfy our boundary conditions. So when x equals L, CA is CAS, which means that CAS equals C1 times the hyperbolic cosine of lambda times L. And so therefore, this is the value of C1, which I can substitute back here and get the concentration of A, where L, remember, is the length of the pore. And then I can look at the other boundary condition, that the derivative of the concentration of A with respect to x equals 0 at x equals 0. And so the derivative, CS is a constant, this hyperbolic cosine denominator is a constant, and the derivative of the hyperbolic cosine is going to be lambda times the hyperbolic sine of lambda x, evaluated x equals 0. This term then is 0 at x equals 0, which means this derivative is 0, so we satisfied our other boundary condition with this solution. So we've completed one of our objectives. We've determined the concentration as a function of x. This says as x increases, the concentration increases, because remember x in our original diagram, x equals 0, we have the lowest concentration of CS at x equals L. So now what we want to do is calculate the effectiveness factor, which is the rate of reaction in this pore, divided by the rate of reaction in the pore if the concentration was uniform everywhere and equal to this value at the inlet to the pore, CAS. We could integrate over the pore, over the changing concentration to determine the total rate, or we could just calculate what's the net flux of A into the pore, because everything net that diffuses into the pore must react. And so what we're going to do then is calculate this rate of reaction in the pore as being the rate of diffusion into the pore, and that we can calculate from the diffusivity and the concentration gradient evaluated at the pore mouth. So this is the flux into the pore. We need to multiply this by the area to get the total amount diffusing in. We're going to differentiate our concentration term that we derived. So I made the substitution, bringing a constant outside. The derivative of the cosine is lambda times the hyperbolic sine, and this is evaluated x equals L. So I combined the terms together, made the substitutions. This is the hyperbolic tangent of lambda x. Also, substitute back our definition of lambda. We have this equation. Now, we're interested in the effectiveness factor, which means the rate of reaction divided by the rate if CA equals CAS everywhere. So I want to divide this right side then by the area for reaction, and then rate of reaction per area. And now I can simplify these terms, where this is our effectiveness factor. I'm going to go through and cancel out terms, try and simplify this. I end up with this expression, which I've rearranged by putting the constant in denominator and written them in this form, because notice that this term here is just lambda. So I'm going to end up with that the effectiveness factor for this pore is the hyperbolic tangent of lambda L over lambda times L. So what is commonly done is to define a new variable, lambda times L, which is called the Thiele modulus. And so the effectiveness factor is the hyperbolic tangent of the Thiele modulus divided by the Thiele modulus. And what I've done is then plot the Thiele modulus on the x-axis and effectiveness factor on the y-axis. This is on a linear scale, showing as the Thiele modulus increases. Thiele modulus increase means our one way is the rate constant increases, then the catalyst becomes less effective. Or as the diffusivity decreases, then it becomes less effective. Or as the diameter of the pore gets smaller, it's more difficult diffusing in, it's less effective. And then it's often plotted on a log scale. And so this shows that we can determine how effectively use this catalyst pore for reaction if we know the rate constant, the diameter pore, and the diffusivity, and the length of the pore.